Live, Laugh, Larceny discusses true petty crimes that may be disturbing to some.
Or could be easy listening to all you psychopaths out there.
All stories are based on actual events. But details may vary.
Listener discretion is not advised.
Live.
Laugh.
Larceny. Welcome to Live, Laugh, Larceny. Begging for an invite so you can have something to cancel later. This is Trevin.
And I'm Amanda. You know, it's always nice to be invited, sometimes just for the simple fact that you can turn it down.
I absolutely love it. Yesterday I was having one of these feelings because our neighbors, the ones right next to us and the ones we hate, they recently got a pool.
Oh.
And I'll tell you, all the plain white people be flocking for pool parties. I swear they have one like twice a week.
Damn.
But we're sitting here watching them have people park in front of our house. And, you know, we don't mind.
Yeah.
I was thinking about selling parking in my driveway, honestly. But I was thinking, I want an invite.
Right. I don't want to go, but I want you to think of me.
Yeah. I mean, I don't swim in public. I don't swim with people, so it doesn't really matter, but I still wanted an invite. I wanted to know that I was worthy of that fun.
I was wanted. Well, that's a dreadful dilemma, but do you actually have another one this week?
I have one that's better than that one.
Oh, okay.
So I know you had one about marketing not too long ago, but I want to talk about marketing too.
Okay.
And I don't know if you ever did this in school. I had to do this. It was probably an English class or something where we had to make a fake business. It was like a class project.
Mm-hmm.
You make a fake business. They would say like, oh, give it a fun name. Give it a fun pitch. What do you guys do? And of course, it's like a really dumbed down version. It's like, what do you do? And it's like, we feed homeless people. And they don't ask questions like, how do you afford the food? Or where does it come from? And you're like, that's not the point. My business is to do this.
Right.
It was mainly like a practice in branding. They would say, oh, give yourself a fun pitch. Give yourself a fun look. What are you guys doing? I remember almost every single class, majority of them were all like T&B this, because everybody just did their first initials.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, that was a fun kind of creative class project for me to do, because it was a way to be creative in a team environment. And I like that sort of thing. So I was driving to work on Friday. And I saw a sign for a local business, and it just made me think, maybe I should be a business runner.
Oh, no.
Because I think fourth grade me would have done a bit better job.
Oh, God. Let's see it.
I didn't take a picture.
Oh, you didn't?
No, I couldn't. It was not safe.
Oh, well, safety is the number one priority, I guess.
But this was a little black sign written in what looked like chalk that just said, gutter cleans. And then I had a number.
Okay.
They didn't say, I will clean your gutter. They didn't say, clean gutters are my thing. It just said gutter cleans.
Gutter cleans.
Gutter cleans.
And it didn't even say gutter cleaning.
Nope.
Gutter cleans.
Yes.
That is just not proper grammar.
It's not proper. I mean, I wasn't going to call them. Did they not make it in that fourth grade class? Like, did they not make it past that?
Good God. Okay, maybe their grammar is poor, but also just a plain backdrop. At least hit us with something interesting to look at, like Jungle Law does with their billboards.
Oh, boy. Oh, that's what it was, probably, was your Jungle Law dilemma.
That probably was. Which, for all of our Kansas City locals, I personally keep seeing more and more Jungle Law billboards pop up.
And of course, this is all a big fun joke. It could have just been that they didn't speak great English.
Mm.
But there are situations like when somebody mass produces a sign and puts them all over the place, there's some checks and balances that should probably happen, even if you don't speak that language super well.
Mm-hmm.
Like if you told me right now, I need you to make a sign that's going to be in Portugal.
Yeah.
I would have Google translated it.
Right.
I would have asked around.
Right. Was it one of those really tiny little ones with like the metal rods pointing into the ground? Yeah. And maybe it's because they wanted to use as little wording as possible to get as much visibility on the small sign. But still, you could have done gutter cleaning or something that was smaller that wasn't that.
So you think this was more of like a Kevin from The Office thing? Like, exactly. Why use many words when few do tricks?
Yes.
Okay. That's a great argument, too.
Yeah.
This person's so efficient. Honestly,
maybe we're the dipshits here.
That would be a great way to market themselves. Just be like, I am so damn efficient.
Gutter cleans.
Yeah. Before you hang up the phone with me, I'm going to have your gutters cleaned. All right.
Wow. This isn't dreadful any longer.
Free marketing. Here we go. Gutter cleans, everybody. Look them up.
Look them up. Wow. Dreadful. Well, I also have a dreadful dilemma this week. Something that has happened to me that I am still very bitter about, and we're recording a little bit ahead. So by the time this comes out, when my family listens to this, they're going to be like, you're still mad about that, weirdo? No.
It's been weeks.
This is recorded ahead of time. So all of my family decided to leave me this week. I'm talking my mom and dad. There goes the kid sitter. Mm-hmm. I'm talking my brother and sister-in-law, my cousin and his wife, and my husband. I'm talking all these people decided that they all needed to go on vacations at the exact same time. And I was there to do everyone's house sitting, everyone's pet watching, and the kids all to myself. So yes, I know this sounds like I'm still bitter about this, but hey, maybe I deserve to be. When this comes out, maybe I can still be bitter.
I talked to you days leading up to it, and you're like, peace and love. Mm-hmm. I'm going through it for the next couple days. Was it as bad as you anticipated it would be?
No, it was worse for me in different ways than I thought. But in the other ways, it was better. So let me explain. I thought, oh my God, I have four dogs, a cat, and then the dogs and the cat, and they don't really get along, and then the babies. And I was just like, I'm going to be running around. Everyone's going to need something. I'm going to have to be breaking up fights. I'm going to be blah, blah, blah. But it wasn't really that. My kids actually behaved very well for me.
That's
I'm
good.
Talking surprisingly well, both of them. Maybe they felt bad for me. I don't know. But everyone got along. The animals were good. It really wasn't as stressful. And like a lot of the times when I was going over to do the house sitting, it was just during the day and I went at my own time. Yeah, it was a lot of my own time, but it wasn't horrible. The thing that affected me more than anything was honestly just the emotions of knowing that everyone was out at vacation and I was at home just cleaning up dog vomit in the corner.
Oh, yeah. Everybody's having fun and you're working for them.
Yeah. My parents are sending me pictures of the ocean. And then my husband was out at the lake at a friend's house. And I was just like, oh, here's the dogs, you know? No, honestly, I was sending pictures of the kids. But you know what I mean? I was just jealous.
It was your everybody hurts kind of situation.
Yes.
Again.
Yes. Feel bad for me.
Everybody's like sipping out of coconuts and you're having microwave dinners and crying into plastic.
Exactly. So this week we are going to be doing a game of Would You Rather.
Would you rather? We are, and it's your week to serve it up hot.
So we haven't done a game of Would You Rather in a while. I mean, you and I have talked about it, I believe, on the podcast before. That's just one of them that we won't do as much because, honestly, it's more about personal opinions.
And we don't have them.
Yeah, what? But this one I thought of just randomly. It wasn't even a would you rather question for the show. I just was cleaning one day and I was listening to something, can't even remember what. And I just said, oh, would I rather be in this situation or this? And I was like, oh, hell yes. Would you rather game? Here we go.
Boom.
So, Trevin, would you rather be lost at sea or be lost in space?
Okay, so because of the current, well, at the time of us recording it, the current trending news right now about the submarine, I've actually kind of had similar thoughts too about like, oh, I would rather be like stuck in space than underwater.
Right.
Like that submarine situation.
I guess when I was thinking lost at sea, it was like on a boat, not in
you're
a submarine.
You're talking like castaway type
yes.
stuff.
Yes. You're still living. You still have some supplies, but like, who knows?
Big bodies of water scare me. mm-hmm. and big fish and orca whales and all these things are very scary to me.
Mm-hmm.
But I always come back to this. I would probably fail trying to get back home from space.
Mm.
Even yeah. if I was an astronaut who knew how to rig up the spaceship correctly, I'd probably screw up into the atmosphere and yeah. like hit my planet that I want to get back to and hurt it in some way. So
worst astronaut ever.
Yeah. Even though I think a giant bass fish could eat me out of the ocean or something, I would have a better chance of surviving somehow than being stranded in space.
Yes, I agree with you. I think that I would also choose lost at sea. Now, if we're talking underwater, though, yeah. if we're talking submarine and space, those to me are actually kind of even. If we're talking lost at sea and I'm up above water on a boat, I am 1,000,000% choosing that. But now that I'm honestly thinking about it,
mm-hmm.
if you're in a submarine lost and you're in space lost, no one can see you, you know, mm-hmm. from the naked eye. They're going to have to use something for both of those. Whereas a boat, people can see that. So maybe the question should have been about a submarine. I don't know.
Yeah.
Ugh. But with my original question, I think I would go with lost at sea as well, just because I think you have a higher chance of getting out of that situation than being lost in space.
And I can breathe outside of my boat, but I can't breathe outside of my spaceship.
I know. I should have done the underwater lost at sea. Those are really comparable. I honestly don't know which one I would choose. I guess you and I are not future astronauts.
No.
And I'm okay with that.
I couldn't pass the math test probably anyway.
Oh God, me neither.
That's a fun one to think about. The lost at sea hypothetical or, mm-hmm. or the lost at deserted island. I always think those are fun to think about.
Mm-hmm.
But I've got a would you rather for you.
Okay.
Would you rather have a blockbuster movie made about the most embarrassing moment of your life, or cure cancer and have nobody believe you or put your plan into action?
I thought you were just going to say cure cancer, but you won't get any of the credit. And I was like, well, I'm not that big of a dick. I'd still choose that one.
Right.
But if no one's even going to use my damn cure.
Mm-hmm. It's like a long would you rather, but I had to make that very clear. It's
no,
like,
yeah.
of course I would choose to cure cancer and not get any thanks for it. But no, I'm saying you have the answers. And every time you're like tugging on the jacket saying, hey, I've got it. They're like, not right now. We're worried about.
And you're
something
saying
else.
It will never, they will never use
they
it.
They will never listen to you.
Ever.
Well, I mean, you don't know that. You know, you're still trying really hard, hoping that maybe you can convince somebody, but let's just assume that it's a mission that you're going
to
fail.
But it also sucks to have my most embarrassing moment, shitting my pants in the airport, as a blockbuster hit.
Mm-hmm. Imagine you got paparazzi coming after you, be like, oh my God, I can't believe Brad Pitt played as you shitting in an airport. Which I don't know why they gender swapped you, but they did.
Because God forbid a woman shart, okay?
Exactly. Hey, you need to take it back.
Women only poot. They don't shart. I don't know. God, I guess that makes it a good would you rather.
Yeah.
This really shouldn't be this hard, and I really want to make you answer before me, but I won't do it.
You know, the funny thing is, I just now decided what I was going to do. I had never really thought about it for
I
myself.
I never think of mine. I usually am just like, ooh, that's a tough one, and I don't think of it. I guess the pro of having the blockbuster, maybe you would get some money, whatever. Maybe you'd get some recognition, but the attention would be very negative. And if you were to do the other, cure cancer, you're getting zero attention at all. You can tell attention means a lot to me, right? So
right.
This is how I'm weighing it.
Hey, I just love that you admit that, you know? I feel like a lot of people.
I love attention. Are you kidding me? Oh my God, Trevin. More people need to admit that, okay? Because I see you. I know who you are because I am you. I guess I would rather die knowing that I cured cancer than die knowing that I'm known as the sharter in the airport.
That is great because that makes us different.
Ooh, okay.
I would choose the embarrassing movie for the recognition.
Okay.
Because you could still launch a podcast career with it. You can still monetize
That's
off of
true.
It.
That's true.
I could be so lucky.
God, I guess it's true. I don't know. But for your most embarrassing moment, do you have one in mind?
No, I mean, I don't think I have anything to be that embarrassed about, really.
Yeah.
But I mean, I've had some embarrassing ones, but just think about Joe Exotic. That was an embarrassing situation for
him.
I mean, of course he's in jail. Imagine like making a Joe Exotic level blunder without going to jail. being a huge hit.
Yeah.
And then being like, people are laughing at me.
Let's get real. You've made me change my mind.
Yeah.
Because what if Kristen Wiig played me or something? That would be a dream.
Love that.
Someone that amazing playing you? Okay, I changed my mind. Give me all the attention. Kristen Wiig, where are you?
Ugh, I say that every night. Yeah, and I just think that I'm a person who's very goal-oriented. Mm-hmm. And if there is something that just drives me, like with a fiery passion that says, you've got to do this, there is nothing more defeating than knowing that you can't succeed at that thing. And if I knew that I had something as powerful as the cure for cancer, and I was always just knocking on doors and getting told no, it would be an obsession that would haunt me every day. So I wouldn't want to do that.
You know what, Trevin? Usually when we do these and we have opposite answers, your explanations, no offense, but they just don't usually do it for me. Usually I'm like, no, I'm still sticking with my answer, but I think you honestly really have swayed my opinion. Fine. I'll be known as the sharder in the airport.
Matt Damon.
Matt Damon all the way. So, Trevin, you know what isn't embarrassing, though?
Matt Damon ads?
We could only be so lucky, but here are some ads. And we are back and ready for story time.
I'm buckled into this couch.
So I've kind of been building this up to Trevin a little bit, and now I'm about to build it up for the rest of you all. But I think it's going to pay off. Like, this isn't just like an empty promise of hope, okay?
Which we're known for.
No, this is real life stuff, guys. Mm. So my story today is a listener story, and it was sent in by someone who I am not going to give their real name by request. And I think at the end of this, you guys will maybe understand why.
Ooh, it's one of those.
It's juicy.
We haven't had one of those in a while, an anonymous one.
Oh, God, this is so good. Not only is the story itself just a good crime story, right? But, and I've said this before, we have some amazing listeners that have written and they've been amazing writers. And I've said, and I've given them credit, and I've said, I used so much of their stuff here and there, blah, blah, blah. But I am here to tell you that this might be the most thorough and detailed story that I have ever received.
Do we need to give this person our job?
I was just telling my mom, I was like, you know, this one story that I did, it kind of felt like I was plagiarizing an assignment, like at school or something, because there was just so much good writing here already. It was magical. And I just want to say, I think you guys are all going to enjoy it.
Oh, good. You know, that's actually how I felt about the trash can stealing story as well.
Oh, okay.
I don't think I gave that listener enough credit, but that was very well done. And I even took a lot of her jokes as well.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. I almost feel like a little plagiarizer because a lot of this is our listener. I mean, I added my own stuff, but damn, I'm giving all the credit I can right now. And it's hard because I can't even say their real name.
Yeah.
Before I jump into the story, I just want to read a part of the email, though.
Okay.
So here's the email. Hi, Amanda and Trevin. I've been a fan for about a year now, and I've listened to all of your previous episodes. I've really enjoyed your show. It's brought me many laughs and so much joy. Thank you for your hard work and effort in putting your amazing show together. Below is my true petty crime story for your consideration. I give you full permission to use it however you see fit. This is my story and my confession. I mean, this is real. Also, another side note, when it came to me asking what name to use for the story, he said, oh, in terms of names, as I still live in town, please come up with a lovable rascal name for me. Dealer's choice. So, okay, can you just like already understand that this listener is great? Also, he is from Australia. And just because I am a basic bee who loves reality television and Vanderpump Rules, there's only one Australian on the show and his name is Brock. And I'm giving you Brock. So that is that. And here we go. Sounds of an engine revving and screeching tires pierce through the air inside an empty car park. The person riding shotgun inside of the vehicle causing the ruckus was a man in his 40s named Brock. The person behind the wheel was Brock's oldest child,
and brand new driver. After practicing yielding, turning, and parallel parking, Brock suggested they give their necks a break from the whiplash and pull over. He stepped out of the passenger side door to stretch when he noticed the familiar clubhouse across the street from them. Seeing it now made Brock chuckle to himself, as he had made plenty of petty memories there. It seemed like just yesterday, when he had first stepped foot on the elitist and manicured property, as he reflected back to 20-some years ago. It was in the early 2000s. Brock was a young man in his 20s, living a recklessly carefree life.
Let's have ice cream for dinner!
He had a close group of friends that encouraged this lifestyle, because they too were living it. When they got together, they would do the typical young guy things, such as playing video games, cruising around the city, and watching pirated movies. But at night, the guys loved nothing more than a bout of urban exploration with a side of criminal mischief. One of these occasions involved Brock and the guys taking various street signs from around town and putting them up at a local playground. They placed a 100-kilometer speed limit sign above the slide and a slippery when wet sign next to the drinking fountain. But this was just one example of how hilarious they thought they were. On another night, the crew decided to stray into one of the town's more affluent areas. Immediately, they felt a shift in environments as the average ground turned into manicured lawns. The air smelled of pine and oak from the beautiful trees lining the streets. After walking a while, Brock noticed that they had left the streets and driveways of the suburbs behind and now found themselves in a densely wooded area devoid of lights and houses. The friends had no idea where they were, but continued on. In the low light of the summer evening, they failed to see the black chain link fence until they all walked right into it. After some expletives and other expressions of shock,
fuck me sideways,
the guys recovered their composure. Brock wondered why there would be a chain link fence in the middle of the woods, and he wasn't the only one. Because they were a group of young, curious, and macho enough men that couldn't be stopped by a fence, they collectively came to an unspoken decision. They would be going over the fence to explore. On the other side, they found a wonderland of the most beautiful landscaping they had ever seen. The grass was lush and thick, becoming shorter in more open areas. The trees and bushes were all pruned into artistic shapes. There were ponds with statuesque fountains, sending water sparkling into the night air. There were paths and walkways which were so well maintained that walking on them made them feel like they had entered the grounds of a palace. Exploring this beautiful gardenscape, Brock began to notice some odd garden decorations. There were small signs for sporting brands that seemed to form borders along certain grassed areas. There were pavilions set up at random places throughout the garden. There were odd-shaped sand pits at weird intervals. And for some reason, there were flags on poles sitting in holes in the ground. Eventually, it dawned on them that they had found their way into the fanciest golf club in town. The entry sign read, Royal Canberra Golf Course. After realizing their location, a sense of anarchy seeped into the guys' souls. Being that they were from a lower socioeconomic background than those that could afford to join such an elitist establishment, they felt it was their duty to send these club-swinging, money-having, not-poor-being fat cats a dose of reality. And so, the shenanigans started. The guys cut circles of grass from the edge of the putting green and put it into the holes, making the holes completely invisible to the future golfers. They used the flags as javelins against the statuary and even reworked a fountain, making it look like the statue was peeing into the pond.
It's peeing!
The next thing the guys discovered was an unlocked shed, full of golf carts. They immediately jumped on and took the carts for the best joyride their video game-inspired hearts could give them. They jousted with the flags, crashed a bunch of times into the sand traps, and zoomed at full speed along the perfect fairways. As the night came to an end and the dawn sunlight threw pink into the sky, it was time to flee. Brock and his friends decided to take the carts back to their shed and plug them in as a renewable source of future entertainment. They already knew what their plans would be for next weekend. The following week, Brock woke up to the local news station playing on his TV. In his shock, they were talking about what he and his friends had just done. In a surprising event of vandalism involving peeing statues, Royal Canberra Golf Course had to reschedule today's golf tournament. The story remained newsworthy for a few days, but the boys were undeterred and fully intended on karting again. And so began the battle between the guys and the golf course security team. Each time Brock and his friends broke into the course, the security had made new futile attempts to keep them out, only for the resourceful friends to overcome the latest obstacle. It started with a pathetic padlock on the golf cart shed, which the guys easily broke through. Other attempts of security updates included a bigger padlock, a new sliding bolt, a whole new door, and a construction girder that blocked the carts from driving out. But each time, the friends were still able to extract the golf carts. Overcoming the latest security measure had become almost as enjoyable as the joyride themselves. This back and forth went on for months, but as the old saying goes, all good things must come to an end. The last time the crew went karting, they had gotten through the beefed up perimeter fence, snuck past the sleepy security guard, accessed the shed, and lifted the carts out. At this stage, security had chained all of the carts together, but instead of this stopping the fun, they sped off connected, creating a golf cart centipede of sorts. Only about 10 minutes into the drive, the unmistakable sound of sirens went off in the distance. The lead driver of the cart conga line sped them back towards the shed, but accidentally steered them off the path and into a tree.
Oh shit!
Immediately, the tree cracked loudly, causing the guys to jump off just in time to watch the large tree fall and crush the carts. Although this wasn't their intended parking spot, it had to do, as the guys ran away from the property and never returned. Suddenly, Brock was back to his current reality of sitting in the empty car park with his oldest child, who was just learning to drive. But the 20-year flashback stayed in the forefront of Brock's mind. The next day, he sat down and started writing out his full petty crime story for one of his favorite podcasts. Actually writing it all down made Brock feel nostalgic, and he decided to return back to the scene of the crime. The golf cart shed looked exactly the same as he last saw it, and against his better judgment, he decided to test the security one last time. He managed to get inside of the shed and take a cart out.
Just like old times.
However, this time, instead of taking it for a joyride, he parked the cart just outside of the shed, letting the security team know he still got it.
Whoa, that makes me think of those movies where it's all a flashback of an older person who's retired and they're like, I don't do that anymore. And then at the end of them telling their whole backstory, they walk out and they're just like, one last time.
So Brock does not know, probably, that I'm going to add that. So let me kind of tell how this happened from my perspective. So we received this email. Like I said, there were full-on paragraphs of the description of the golf course that I did not touch, people. Clearly, there is some talented writing here. Uh-huh. I received the first email. really not many follow-up questions. I just wanted to know if we could use the correct name or where this took place. Those were the only questions I had.
Mm-hmm.
Brock then not only gave me those answers, but then the email continued on and he told me that after sending in the email, he literally went back to the scene of the crime and did everything that I just said.
Hmm.
He went back in, tested the security, was still able to get a card out, but he just left it right outside just to let him know. I still know how to do this.
I mean, that's crazy to even keep trying. For me personally, after seeing one new measure taken,
mm-hmm.
my brain would start connecting dots, thinking they were more prepared than they were. And I'd be like, nope, not going to do it.
Right. I know. They were very confident in themselves. I mean, I get how now he would go back 20 years later. And he also said he was trying to find to see if there was any news articles about it. But he said it's been so long, he couldn't find anything. Not only was the story good, it was just an amazing story, well written, but the fact that there was even a follow-up that he actually returned there blew my mind. So I hope everyone enjoyed that story as much as I did.
It does make me think about those movies, except the movie began with Brock sitting down, writing down his story, you know?
Right!
And then it fades out, and then the very end of it, he stops and licks the envelope, sends it off, and then returns to the scene.
Right.
One more time.
I know, except for it was an email. But, right, you know, cinematically, it can be a letter for sure.
Isn't that funny how we still use classical things because it's just more poetic?
Yeah.
Like,
oh, yeah.
Like when we do sound effects, I still do typewriters. Oh, and like old telephone sounds for telephone sounds.
Yeah.
And it's just like more poetic. It's just more fun.
It's way more poetic. But yeah, I hope that I did the story justice. I did add my own stuff here and there, but a lot of it was his. But I personally and creatively decided to start it kind of like a movie with a flashback because when he was telling me about writing in, the thing that motivated him was taking his oldest child to go driving,
mm-hmm.
and he saw the clubhouse. I mean, literally, I didn't make any of this up. So even the flashbacks that are all like dramatized and whatever are really what he told me.
It's also really cool, too, to think that he took that trip down memory lane solely for our show.
That is a very cool point.
Like, yeah. I'm going through therapy and like going back through things in my past.
Yeah.
And he went through and reprocessed those days. All because of our show.
Yeah. Obviously, I can't tell you all. Go out and steal some golf cards. I'm not going to encourage being a petty criminal, even though, let's get real, I've done things like that myself. But it does sound fun. And I'm sure it was fun for him to think of all those fun memories that he had. I know for me, even though my kids are still young, I've been able to remember some of the things I did when I was younger. And I don't know. I just thought it was a really cool way. And that's a very interesting point that he went through that. He wrote the story for a show, reprocessed those memories, and then went back. It's really cool.
It's just a beautiful thing.
Yeah. God.
Well, that was a great story. Thank you, Barack, for sending it in.
Yes.
And I've got a story.
Oh my God, I cannot wait.
And there's something oddly nostalgic about this story for me as well.
Huh.
I don't know what it is about this one. Maybe it's just the kind of story or the things that I'm tackling with it. But something about this story, it feels like I'm going back to our roots a little bit.
Oh, you told me that. Yeah, you said it was like early, seriously sinister day vibes.
I don't really know what exactly about it is, but just the crime feels like a seriously sinister crime.
Whoa, I'm ready. For those of you who, maybe this is episode one.
Yeah.
Our show used to be called Seriously Sinister. It was very overly sarcastic because clearly our show has always been what it is. That's what we're talking about.
Yeah. And nothing's changed, but just something about the kind of crimes that we did back then. I think it more has to do with just like where our headspaces were.
Hmm.
I've gone through different phases in my story writing for this show where I'm like, that was where I was going through this and this. Something about this one just brought me back to those old feelings for some reason.
Wow. Loving it. Can't wait.
So let's just jump into this and see if I'm talking out my ass or not. And here we go. Out of all the different social encounters that we as people endure, there is one that deals the most damage: being rubbed the wrong way. And I'm not talking about a masseuse who has really rough hands.
My God!
I'm talking about the times where you couldn't quite process the intentions of another person's actions. Do they hate me? Are they just awkward? Or is this the first step to their master plan of manipulating me into joining the sex cult they're trying to form?
The safe word is wiener.
All legitimate possibilities. Perhaps a more modern term would be the vibes were off. The vibes being off is the silent killer of all social interactions in the 21st century. Unlike a heated argument divulging into a fist fight,
come at me, bitch!
Or a flirty dinner leading to your first time trying anal, being rubbed the wrong way can leave you feeling confused. As soon as the perplexing action occurs, every word chosen and movement made are scrutinized. Does this person need their ass kicked? You ask yourself, as you feel threatened by the way they secretly tried to pick their nose at the dinner table. The unknown seeps into your pores and courses through your bloodstream. You're no longer present in the moment as thoughts race through your mind, trying to connect the dots and make sense of it. At this point, you're hooked and there's no way out. Besides communicating, of course. But we aren't going to do that. I call these situations the silent killer, because once a dialogue descends into this territory, it's no longer you communicating with the other person. It is now you versus a highly dramatic version of yourself. And that voice in your head is dead set on being offended. The negative self-talk escalates as a friend's sudden break from eye contact leads you to draw conclusions. With each stroke from your metaphorical pencil, your creativity and imagination shines as you expertly weave a narrative explaining that your friend broke eye contact because they were secretly thinking about your unresolved trauma. You take a step back from your creation, admire your craftsmanship, and cry, knowing that you just wasted all of that effort hurting your own feelings in the most beautiful way. I'm going to go out on a limb here and assume everyone has had a situation like this. It sucks. Some of us are more susceptible to them than others, depending on our own mental well-being and the people we choose to keep around. Either way, we never fully avoid them. This week, I wanted to help raise a little awareness as to why we may do this to ourselves, and also tell a petty crime story revolving around the same theme. So lotion up your thin skin and fill out a hurt feelings report, because we're about to get offended. Elliot was a 22-year-old living in Chicago, Illinois. Like every young American in 2021, he needed money and a steady future. But in this economy, neither of those things were a guarantee, which led Elliot to do some shady acts for cash. In several instances, Elliot would fill out applications, dress in a suit, tell rehearsed lies to sell a fake version of himself,
I'm a very hard worker,
adhere to a dress code, ask someone else permission to have
Please,
free time,
I need a break,
and earn way below what he is worth. That's right. In order to survive during this time, Elliot had to get a job. But before you think this is the scariest story I've ever told on this show, it gets worse. Elliot had a character flaw. For as long as Elliot could remember, he was always getting offended. It was as if the filter in his brain that processes hurt feelings came faulty from the factory and he never activated his warranty. Because of this, he would often leave social situations and relationships a much worse place than he found them. Having this particular character flaw could be great for some professions, like starring in the next season of RuPaul's Vanderpump Circle, or keeping up with the survivors. But when you're just trying to make it as a low-level worker in corporate food chains, characters aren't welcome, and they made that very clear. Elliot could not hold down a job due to his dramatic reactions to off-putting situations. He threw a Frosty in a customer's face while working at DQ.
DQD's nuts.
He purposely gave customers he didn't like brown rice instead of white at Chipotle. And he didn't even get hired at McDonald's because he said the Big Mac special sauce wasn't that special.
Get the fuck out.
At this point in his professional career, the only food chain that would hire him was Waffle House. But even he knew he was too dramatic for that place. This was a real struggle for Elliot. It's not like he was a loud and expressive person. Quite the opposite, actually. If you met Elliot in passing, you would think he was a strong, silent type. His image exuded a confident stillness. But the second something affected him personally, the gloves were off and the claws were out. To a lot of his other tough guy friends, he played it off like he was a man who takes no shit and handles his business. But his memory of the occurrences were always one-sided, leaving him the victim in some way. "Ugh, I'm so angry," Elliot wailed as he busted through the front door of his mother's house. "What's the matter, dear?" his mom asked, coming to his aid. "I got fired from another job, which is such bullshit," Elliot replied. "All I did was put a live mouse in Gina's water cup, but she told me I looked nice today and it felt backhanded, like she didn't even mean it." Elliot's mother couldn't believe what she just heard. "Well, it sounds like you did the right thing getting away from such a bad influence, dear," she surprisingly responded as she sat at the table. "I'm sorry to hear about you losing your job. The right one is out there. I just know it. But I do have some bad news." The woman slumped more into her chair and went on about how she made a few bad bets on $50 scratcher tickets, and now she needs Elliot to start paying rent. Initially, Elliot responded in the way that a good son would. He said he understood and accepted the rent of $200 a month. However, something about the whole interaction rubbed Elliot the wrong way. The more his mother went on about how sorry she was to be charging him, Elliot's brain was doing mental gymnastics, turning this into an act of retaliation by his mother. What started as a scratcher addict's cry for help flipped and twisted itself into Elliot making this whole thing about how his mother stopped liking him after he grew facial hair. "I'm not your baby anymore because I look like a man. That's what it is, isn't it?" he screamed in his mother's face as he turned and stormed out of the house. Elliot went on a long nature walk, stopping to pose like the people in those moody posters that are meant to convey one singular emotion.
"Anguish!
I'm tired of running and not knowing where I'm going," he said to himself in the deepest way possible. As he sat there, giving himself time to think things over, he knew that he would have to eventually forgive his mom. This wasn't because it was the right thing to do, or because she was his mother, but because she was essentially his landlord and didn't want to get kicked out. But even with the decision made, he still had one big issue standing in his way. His monthly spending amount has just gone up, and he no longer has a job. Swallowing his pride deep down, Elliot stood up and began walking towards his local Waffle House. It was time to stop crying about his circumstances and start learning the differences between smothered, covered, chunked, topped, and the rest of Waffle House's mini hash brown topping options. But just as Elliot started this very standard lowering excursion, he walked past a very peculiar sight. There, stopped at the side of the street, was a Shy City towing truck. What would have normally looked like just a big white flatbed truck to Elliot ended up looking a lot more like a heaping pile of rent money. "I've never done a crime in my life," Elliot said to himself, contemplating Grand Theft Auto. But as he continued talking to himself about it, he noticed the tow truck driver get out, leave the truck running, and inspect the winch on the back. The moment felt like a sign from the universe. No more hesitating, Elliot quickly darted towards the tow truck, popping the door open and jumping inside.
"What the fuck?"
the driver yelled as he ran back toward the driver's side door. Elliot fumbled with the gear shift, putting the truck in drive.
"I ought to shoot you in the face,"
the man yelled as Elliot turned his head to find himself staring straight down the barrel of a pistol.
"How dare you?"
Elliot screamed as he floored the truck and left its owner behind. Elliot and his new tow truck picked up speed as the encounter replayed in his mind.
"I ought to shoot you in the face. I ought to shoot you in the face.
I ought to shoot you in the face."
He couldn't believe that he just performed his first felony. There was so much excitement between quickly operating a vehicle he didn't know to having a gun pulled on him. But the more he thought back on the latter part of the moment, the more it started to rub him the wrong way.
"Like, I get that I was stealing the truck, but why pull a gun on me?"
he said to the inside of the empty truck.
"It's just a truck. Someone could have gotten hurt with what he did."
On and on, the situation replayed, Even though that man had a reason to react, his form of reacting in that moment greatly offended Elliot. He can't just get away with this, Elliot said to himself as he pulled into his driveway and went inside his home. Ugh, I'm so angry, Elliot yelled as he stormed back into his house. What's the matter, dear? Is it because of me charging you rent? His mom asked. No, a man pulled a gun on me, which is total bullshit, he yelled. All I did was steal his truck. It was a total overreaction on his part. That's illegal. This man sounds awful, honey. What are you gonna do? His mom asked with much anxiety. Elliot dramatically stopped, pulled out his cell phone, and slowly looked back at his mom. I'm going to call the cops on him. In January of 2021, 22-year-old Chicago man, Elliot Scott, stole a Chi City towing truck from the 7400th block of South Exchange. During the theft, there was a heated altercation where the driver of the tow truck pulled out a gun in an attempt to stop the carjacking. The driver did not shoot, opting instead to provide the Chicago PD with the GPS location of the truck so that it may be recovered. Although Scott had gotten away with the truck, he too had felt affected by the confrontation. As the police were on their way to seize the tow truck and arrest Elliot Scott, the Chicago PD 911 operator had received a call from him themselves. In the phone call, Scott had explained that he stole a tow truck from a local tow company, but was upset when the driver pulled a gun on him in the process. When police arrived, Scott was found in the driver's seat of the truck, where he was taken into custody. In court, the judge questioned the report, thinking it was misrecorded due to the bizarre details. Elliot Scott was charged with aggravated possession of a stolen motor vehicle, misdemeanor theft, and driving on a suspended or revoked license. He was allowed to serve monitored house arrest and skip paying a cash bail because, quote, he did not use a weapon during this matter. He called the police, apparently upon himself, end quote. So how many of you can relate a little bit to Elliot? Do you ever take a slightly off situation and find ways to make them about something else that upset you? No? Okay, liar. I can definitely say that I have, and not in a gigantic blow-up situation either. Sometimes a person's actions can really send me down a rabbit hole of bad thoughts. Something as simple as a friend canceling plans can lead me down to the conclusion that maybe the plans were canceled with me because someone made better plans. Of course, I don't go so far as to react dramatically, but I can internalize them and carry those feelings down for a while. I know that those kinds of conclusions are more coming from my own issues with worthiness and self-image, but I don't always think that through when I'm experiencing the initial anxiety of it all. Because of that, I can put myself in a bit more of an irritable mood, and nobody deserves to put up with an irritable me if they aren't the ones that caused it. So don't be like Elliot. If someone rubs you the wrong way, take a serious step back and see if they really meant harm or if you're just being dramatic. You might just surprise yourself with how many annoying situations you can work through and not project onto others. A little bit of self-awareness can go a long way, because nobody wants to be known as the guy who stole a truck and called the police to tell on your victim.
I mean, I wouldn't want to be remembered in that way, for sure.
I mean, that is an impressive oversight.
Oh my God, it's almost scary how unaware people can be, but that's a whole nother rabbit hole we can go down. So he really, really probably in his mind thought, what did he even think? Like they were going to come and he was going to say, he held up a gun and they were like, okay, you can drive off with the stolen tow truck then. Thank you for your time.
Yeah. From everything I've understood, he literally did say, I stole a truck, but the guy pulled a gun on me and that's the issue.
Wow.
It's not like he said, oh, I had a weird encounter with this guy and he pulled a gun on me and he tried to like skirt past that little detail.
Right.
He was pretty much just like, well, yeah, I did it, but this guy had a gun though. Like that's kind of messed up, don't you think?
God.
So I guess that just made me think of a seriously sinister story because I had a lot of stories back in the day where it was kind of people doing kind of a ridiculous thing based off of a small misunderstanding. Mm. And plus, we had a bunch of tow truck stories in the beginning, I feel like.
Oh, yeah. A lot of stolen vehicles.
Yeah.
For sure. Even like past the subject matter, I can't even remember what point of the story it was. But there was a time when you were reading part of it and I was like, That does feel like a nostalgic story. I'll have to rethink of what part it was. Mm-hmm. But there was a part where I was like, okay, I see where he's coming from. It just had the old corniness of it all.
Yeah.
You know, like when we first started, when we were like reaching for these corny, which we still do all the time, news stories. But I don't know. There was something about it.
I just feel like this was something more grimy and street level.
Like, yeah.
Lately, we've been a little bit more bigger, higher concepts. And this was just like, you know what? A guy just felt bad that a guy pulled a gun on him.
Right.
And that started it all.
Right. And that is petty.
Yeah. I did forget that when I wrote it, though, I went really kind of deep on the concept of
being rubbed the wrong way.
Well, like the concept of having somebody, maybe they're just a little off, but because of it, you're drawing conclusions that it's about something you're self-conscious
mm-hmm.
about. I was really feeling that as a great character trait.
Yeah.
To play off of.
Oh, yeah.
That's something I don't think we really think about, because I know I do it.
Yeah. Oh, gosh. Yeah. I think that's a pretty common thing, probably. Mm-hmm. I don't know. Let us know, everyone.
Yeah. Do you project your own personal issues into other problems?
Email us. Yeah. Send it to Liv Larson.
Yeah, gmail.com.
Connections. They both involved stolen motorized vehicles.
Okay.
I will also say both of them were a little bit ballsy because my guy, him and his friends, kept returning to the scene of the crime as if they were just totally confident in themselves. And this guy basically turned himself in with full confidence.
So I guess we could just say the audacity.
The audacity of it all.
The audacity of you, Brock. The audacity of that guy pulling the gun on the guy who stole his truck.
How dare you? The audacity of it all, really.
I'll take it.
Maybe I missed this part, but you said the tow truck driver, he didn't get any charges on him then?
No, they didn't say it.
Because I was wondering, like, did he think that maybe he could get away with this whole thing? Because maybe depending on where they live, like the gun laws or whatever. I don't know.
I mean, Chicago's Midwest. It wouldn't surprise me if they were kind of about the same level as us. Mm. It's probably okay.
Yeah.
The guy got to keep his anonymity too. I mean, they did give the company's name. It was Chi City Towing.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if he was the owner or not, but
wow,
they never gave his name. They just gave the name of the dude that told on him. So I think he did the right thing. It was kind of a, I don't know, I don't even want to get into it. It was kind of a stand your ground sort of situation.
Right.
Your vehicle was getting stolen, but he didn't shoot.
Yeah.
He just threatened him, hoping maybe he'd give it up.
Right.
So he did the right thing, because in that situation, the guy could have been a hothead and just started firing. But instead, he was like, we got a GPS on this truck.
Yeah.
Hopefully I can scare him into giving it back. If not, let him go.
Yeah. I mean, I was already on his side.
Yeah.
But
for doing his job and losing his vehicle.
Yes. But the fact that it wasn't like, I'm going to shoot this guy. He was just using it to be like, get out.
Mm-hmm.
And it showed that it was just used as like a, come on, get out. But
yeah, I mean, maybe it was even empty. We don't know.
Okay. I was just curious if he got in any sort of trouble for having that on the job or anything at all, but it probably didn't say, did it?
No, they probably didn't even care. They're like, listen, this dude is so in the wrong.
Give him his truck back. I don't care if he threw a crocodile at your face.
That was another thing too. I don't have any of his backstory or anything. The dude kind of seemed like he took himself as sort of a tough guy.
Yeah.
But the act was just so dramatic that I was just like, oh, I'm going to say he's a silent guy who just blows things out of proportion.
Mm-hmm.
And that was kind of a different type of character we've never really done before. So
yeah,
I like that.
Just based on the crime, I could see that being very accurate. Like if one thing was wrong on his order, he would think that it was like a personal character, like assassination, you know? Mm-hmm. Yeah, I could see him feeling like he was wronged after stealing someone's truck.
Right.
So yeah, I see why you made that connection. But wow, what a time.
What a week.
What a week. And I hope that everyone is having the best time ever. And just remember, no matter the crime, big or small, in the end, we're all doomed.
Doomed to have Matt Damon play as us in a movie about our lives.
Bye.
See ya.
Bye. I know you have a busy day and you're just about to pick up the phone to call Gutter Cleans, but we really appreciate you listening to our show instead.
And whether you're lost at sea or lost in space, hopefully you have a smartphone. Find us on social media and follow us, Facebook, Instagram, TikTok, or Twitter. Live, laugh, larceny.
And if you're a great writer like today's listener was, then please send us your petty crime story, even if you're not. It's totally okay. Live, laugh, larceny at gmail.com.
And give us the same rating you would give Shy City Towing Security. 5 stars across the board. Apple, Spotify, or Good Pods. Leading to your first time trying anal.
I was trying not to.
When I first wrote that, I was like, God, that's a jarring line.
It really was. I was trying to multitask and it didn't let me.
Sorry. I just remembered an old dilemma I wanted to do.
What? Did you just write it down?
Yeah, I just had to write it down. Sorry.
Is it about anal?
No. Anal has nothing to do with it. Ay, ay, ay.